A little while back, I went on the Lifting Vegan Logic YouTube channel, and we addressed the top 10 vegan myths. Basically, a number of ideas that are common in the vegan community, but are not necessarily supported by the science. I'll link the full video below. It's over an hour long, but one of the topics we touched on was the health impact of eating fish. So that's what you'll see today. We talked about the science on the health impact of consuming fish, types of fish, are there safer types and less safe types? Amounts, is there a safe amount of fish to consume? And finally, we talked about the evidence on contaminants like mercury and PCBs. So here is that conversation.
Okay, maybe the most controversial one, fish is unhealthy. What do you think about that?
Actually, very similar. I was thinking about this and a lot of similarities with the oil question. So here we also tend to see a faction of more hardliners that say fish is unhealthy. Mm-hmm. If you eat fish, you're hurting yourself, you're raising your risk of disease. And then there's a softer version that says, fine, fish is okay. Fish is better than the alternatives, but it's not as good as plants. So there's usually these two levels of nuance, right? So again, we can go through the exact same progression of looking at the evidence. First, we look at people who tend to eat more fish in these population studies. They have lower cardiovascular disease risks. They have lower total death. They have lower risks of gastrointestinal cancer, lower risk of neurodegenerative disease. So the blanket claim that that fish is toxic, incredibly difficult to reconcile or to support that. Now, let's look at the specific comparators and the claims that it's not as good as plants. Few people, I think, disagree that it's better than, say, processed red meat, for example, or a large amount of red meat. Most people will agree that it is preferable. Where people kind of diverge is this question of the plants. If I'm eating some fish, and if I remove that, and if I eat only plants, am I better off? And I often see people making this claim with a lot of confidence, saying that removing fish, let's say a couple times a week, which those are usually the recommendations, right? Fatty fish a couple times a week. Saying that removing that fish and adding beans or something like that is going to improve the health effect of the diet. It's possible. It's an interesting theory. But we want to look at whether the evidence supports that, bottom line, right? Mm-hmm. So there's a couple of ways we can do this. So there are some studies that look at direct comparisons, fish compared to plant foods, and isocalorically. It's called substitution analysis. And this comes primarily from, again, observational studies, because they're looking at these long-term outcomes, risk of heart attacks, cancer, death. Very difficult to do a randomized control trial looking at that for technical reasons. Not impossible, but very tough. Bottom line, I've seen maybe half a dozen of these. I've seen some that suggest an edge of plants. I've seen several that suggest no superiority, kind of a tie. The last one that I've seen published is from last year, 2021, and it looked at all of these head-to-head comparisons. So it compared red meat, eggs, fish, nuts, whole grains, all to each other, head to head. As a rule, fish outperformed the other animal products. Plants outperformed the other animal products, but there was a tie across the board between fish and nuts and seeds and whole grains. Mm-hmm. I don't think there was a single outcome where one edged over the other. So again, grain of salt, it's an observational study. We don't jump to the firm conclusion that they are definitely equivalent, but the evidence is suggesting that if there is a difference, it doesn't seem to be massive. It's just not very consistent or very clear. There's no clear superiority there. Maybe a better, a more informative way to look at this is to, rather than looking at these foods in a vacuum, is to look at the entire dietary patterns. This is really what we want to know, right? So comparing vegans to pescatarians, right? That's really the question that people are asking. There's been a number of studies that have looked at that comparison. There's EPIC and Adventists, which people have heard of. Mm-hmm. There's one other from the UK Biobank. The design is pretty similar, and the results are actually pretty similar. So just to give you the example from the Adventist health study, the reference group are the meat eaters. So all the results for pescatarians and vegans are compared to the meat eaters. So for example, for total cancer, vegans had a lower risk of total cancer than meat eaters, and pescatarians did not. However, when you looked at ischemic heart disease, it was the opposite. The pescatarians were significantly lower than meat eaters, but vegans were not. All-cause mortality, total deaths, same thing. Pescatarians were significantly lower. Vegans did not reach statistical significance. So it's just a bit too much uncertainty and a bit too much mixed data to be confident that there's an advantage of one over the other. By the way, I avoid fish and seafood personally, not because I think it's going to kill me, but because of the externalities, right? The primarily for me, the environmental impact, absolutely devastating the environment. So I'd rather, since there's no clear evidence of superiority, I avoid fish. But that's a personal call. That doesn't mean we're going to make stuff up. So I'm not convinced. And we can talk about, you know, there's nuance. If you're eating a boatload of fish, we're going to talk about the contaminants in a second. But there's different types of fish, right? And if you're eating just massive amounts of swordfish or something like that that's very high in mercury, yeah, you might run into problems. But having salmon once or twice a week on top of a plant-rich diet, is that better, worse, or the same? I couldn't tell you. Oh, another thing that's interesting that people often ask, they often say, well, that's because these vegans are probably not supplementing with omega-3s, the DHA and the EPA. And so that's why the pescatarians have a little bit of an edge there. The vegans are probably low in DHA and EPA, but if they were taking the algae oil, then they would kick butt across the board and no other diet would touch them. Possible. Interesting thing to test. Would love to see a really rigorous test of that with a really well-designed vegan diet versus a really well-designed plant-rich diet with fish a couple times a week. I would love to see it. Until we have that, I don't think we should make these confident statements based on an idea or a possibility. Yeah, there's other things that people bring up, the saturated fat content of fish. Fish is also going to have a large amount of these unsaturated fats, the omega-3s. And again, the outcomes are overwhelmingly positive as we kind of went over. The contaminants, probably good to touch a little bit on the contaminants because this is a very, very common question. So it's basically three, mercury, PCBs, and dioxins. For mercury, there's a really good study, an analysis looking at the mercury content in each type of fish. The interesting thing is there's a massive variation in the mercury content from the types of fish that are usually recommended, which is kind of salmon and sardines and these both fattier and not too high on the food chain. And those tend to have very small amounts of mercury versus these fish that are larger and higher up the food chain, like shark, swordfish, some types of bass. They can have 20, 30 times more mercury. So that's something to bear in mind, right? To paint everything with the same brush is not really objective. The issue of contamination is more relevant for certain groups as well. Pregnant women, children, you're going to be more careful there. But again, the benefit, and this all comes down to outcomes. It's kind of, we're starting to sound like a broken record, and so that's a good thing because it all comes down to outcomes.
I mentioned outcomes a lot on the channel, so
yeah. So you know, we can speculate about the effect of contaminants, but you want to look at the health effects. And you typically see lower cardiovascular risk, lower neurological outcomes on people eating fish. So if there's an effect, it doesn't seem massive and it seems to be outweighed by the benefits. You know, if people want to play safe and they say, okay, fine, this is all fine, but I'd rather play safe and not eat any fish and get, you know, beans and maybe the algae oil. That's controversial too, whether the algae oil truly delivers a benefit. But if people want to do that as a strategy, I don't have a problem with it. It's just the confident claim that it's definitely unhealthy. That's not compelling. The PCBs and the dioxins, actually, when you look at the main dietary sources for Westerners, the number one source is our land animals. Beef, chicken, pork account for about a third. Dairy, about a third as well. And then vegetables are actually number three, with about 22% of the PCBs and dioxins that people are taking in are coming from vegetables. Fish and seafood are number four at 9%. And then eggs are about 5%. So if we were looking at the content of PCBs and dioxins exclusively and jumping from that to food health value, if somebody is interested in discouraging consumption of vegetables, as some people on the internet are, they could easily latch onto this and say, look, so we should just not eat salads and go eat fish and eggs all day, because it's going to lower your intake of. I think we all can see through that argument. The main problem is that it's focusing on one molecule that's present and not on the actual health outcomes, the net effect of the food on health. So just a little bit of nuance there.